Well, the idea of a soiled garden, the idea of things being soiled, imperfect, dirty, and growing. I like it, and I think it fits with my piece as well, because that whole idea of the imperfection, the used, the not new and shiny, God knows my pieces aren't new and shiny, and the imperfection business. Traditionally, textiles had to be perfect. It had to be the woman sewing 10 stitches to the inch, and of course that's nonsense. The idea of being creative, of taking the garden, the soil, and growing it, and getting it into a flourishing art form. Art, as a child, it was the only thing I was told I did well. I was able to draw well, not well enough to really be a painter, but I always was creating, always was looking, always was trying to figure things out visually. I went to college as an art major, became an art teacher, and when I became a mother, I realized why women have done textiles through the generations, because you can do it with a small child. You cannot carve stone with an infant. You cannot, God knows, do stained glass with an infant, but you can pick up that embroidery and you can take it with you. And this is why, since prehistoric times, women have done textiles. And so, I sewed. I sewed, and for most of my life, I did it in isolation. Because if you're a working mother, you don't have a lot of studio days. And you certainly don't have time to do things like get them into galleries and get it photographed and get all the paperwork and what have you. But you do have those bits and pieces of time. You have the 5 minutes here and the waiting time. You have the time at the teacher's meeting. You have the time at waiting in line. When if you have the sewing with you, yes, you can sit and you can do it. When you have that odd day, when you can put it all together, you go. And if you have several projects going at once, which I always did, then even if one thing is, okay, we're waiting for that to dry, we're waiting for that to be dyed, but this one I can pull and do right now. And so for a long time, that's what I did. And the interesting thing is, looking back, it allowed me to develop my own voice, which was very different because I wasn't being influenced by the outside. 12 years ago, when my husband said, honey, business is doing well, why don't you drop the day job? And I was able to just dive into it full time and started going to shows and started taking classes and joined a critique group. And at that point, my voice was well developed enough so that when I saw other things, other techniques, you know to take some of them, but to reject others, because you already have your own way of seeing it, of doing it, and you've done it enough to know it's valid. I go to garage sales, estate sales. This is my version of an archaeological dig. Okay, especially if you go to the estate sales and you can go down in the basement and up in the attic and you find the box with the bobbins and the pin cushions and all the little bits and pieces that were common in my mother and my grandmother's era, but aren't today. Because today, no one owns a pin cushion. No one knows what a darning egg is for. But you find these artifacts of a previous time. And I bring them home, and bring home, of course, linens, tablecloths, the embroidery, the crochet. You bring them all home, and you wash it very carefully, and you wash it again, and you dry it, and then you dye it, and you print it, and you process it to death. And then you've got all these materials, and then you go to Photoshop, and you say, okay, here's the materials I've got, here's the image I have in mind, let's put that image with that color, with that, no, none of that works, and you start all over, and you keep going and going until you can really put it together. And then you go downstairs to the work wall, and you start pinning things up, and you pin up the fabric, and you pin this, and you pin that, and again, you keep doing it, and you keep doing it until you say, yeah, this is what works. And then you just sew and sew endlessly. And then half the time you have to rip it apart and sew. But that's the process. I would not ask, neither would you. The history, the archaeology, the pieces, going to these garage sales, finding these bits and pieces, or in the case of the piece behind me, Hiroshima, we spent a month there, and each day I would go to the riverbanks, which at low tide you can access, and you can find all these bits and pieces, some of them still there from the time of the blast. And I know this because I went in to the museum and asked them. And you take these bits, which are just bits of history lying about, and put them together with needle and thread in a way that changes viewer perception of them, changes how we look at it. It's not just some little bits and pieces on the street, but these bits that we find at the garage sale, or in the street, or in people's attic. This is history that's not the history of wars in the State Department and that nonsense. It's history of people. Some queens with daisy crowns. He said, being an artist means that on a beautiful sunny day when all your friends are going to the beach, you'd really rather be in here in the studio chipping away at this goddamn piece of stone. If that's how you feel, that's what you do. You do your art. If that's not how you feel, then get another job that actually pays. Having a supportive spouse is very, very important. My husband's photo should be next to the word supportive in the dictionary. This is a man who will come home from work and say, mind you, there's piles of laundry, the dishes haven't been done. And he'll say, sweetie, good, I'm glad you're doing your art. Listen, can I take you out for dinner or should I just cook for you? That's supportive.